Have you ever wondered how hockey ice is made? How are players able to continue skating on the ice day after day? It's super easy to play hockey on icy, frozen lakes during the winter, but how is hockey in California possible, even when the weather is warm and ice will melt super quickly? Well, today on Highly Technical Sports, we're going to learn about how all of that comes to fruition. We're going to talk about how hockey ice is made in arenas and the difference between good ice and bad hockey ice. So how is ice made? In Canada and in the northern United States, it's cold enough that water will freeze and stay frozen once it's skated on. Water freezes at 32 degrees Fahrenheit, but experts say a good skating day is roughly about 22 degrees Fahrenheit, which is about 10 degrees colder. If the temperature gets much higher than 32 degrees, the ice could break and people could fall in while skating. To have ice that supports 12 people at a time, you're going to need something really cold. Unfortunately, a lot of places won't support that kind of temperature regularly. Only 12 states in the US have an average temperature at or below 22 degrees during the winter. But there are teams and players that play in those 38 other states where it doesn't get quite as cold, so these players are going to have to play in indoor rinks or well-maintained outdoor rinks. So how do they build the ice in these rinks? The first step to building the ice is to find a concrete slab that will fit the requirements of a regulation hockey rink. Typically, most or all of the boards around the ice will already be in place on top of the concrete. Now, it would be extremely hard to turn on the AC and try to freeze the water that will be poured on top of the concrete. So underneath the concrete are approximately 5 miles of steel pipes that have 9,000 gallons of water pumping through them basically at all times. The water is then pumped through the pipes and kept at a brisk 16 degrees Fahrenheit. This cold water, and by extension the cold pipes, help keep that concrete slab in preparation for the actual ice and water to be placed on top. Now that the concrete slab is appropriately cooled with the addition of this ice cold water, it's time for the actual ice to be made. Now, unfortunately, you can't pour a ton of water onto the slab and just let it freeze. If you do that, the ice is going to start to freeze unevenly, causing bubbles to be formed. And why is that bad? Bubbles in the ice cause the surface to become soft, and it slows people down while they skate. Soft ice is typically used for figure skating, which is, they need to do more tricks and so on. So cold or soft ice is really bad for hockey, but great for figure skating. And we want to learn about hockey ice today. So no bubbles and no gallons of water allowed. The first two layers of water are going to be sprayed on via a paint truck, which isn't the same thing as a Zamboni, but it has about the same sort of application, where there are a bunch of little nozzles on the back of the truck that spray misty water out onto the surface of the ice, and so that's how water gets applied. These layers of ice, these first few layers of ice, are just 1/30th of an inch thick, freezing almost as soon as they're sprayed on the cold slab because of how cold the slab is and how thin the layers of water are. So now, after these first two layers are applied, one at a time, we now have a base upon which the rest of the ice is going to start to be placed. And once that second layer is frozen, the ice is sprayed with a third layer of water. It's mixed with a special chemical that prevents the ice from melting while the ice is painted. It's called sealer. So as you might guess, the next step is to then paint the ice. This is when all the markings come on the ice, including the white color for the ice, the team logo, the sponsorship banners, and all that stuff. Some sponsorship banners aren't painted, rather they're just laid onto the ice and then frozen in with the rest of the paint. They might be too hard to paint, or there's a special design that the company wants. Whatever it is, all of the regular markings like face-off dots, the neutral zone, and all the rest of the regular regulation hockey ice paintings are painted on with special paint. The paint is made with chemicals that don't drip or bleed when more water is poured on top of them. Unfortunately, I tried to make my own ice rink without having those special paints, nor did I have the appropriate sealer for the second layer of ice. So once I started pouring that next layer of water on, and once I started painting, the paint started to bleed and it didn't look good. Not that it looked good to begin with, because I'm not really an artist, but once I started pouring more water on, that stuff really started to go, and it just did not look at all like a hockey rink. So it's important that they have those chemicals And it's important that the sponsorship banners be made with the correct stuff, so that the paint doesn't bleed throughout the bottom of the ice. Then it just doesn't look good. What comes next is more water. This time there are less worries about air bubbles or the water freezing unevenly now that you have a solid base. So the crew sprays slash pours 500 to 600 gallons of water at a time onto the ice surface. They wait for each of these layers to freeze before putting on the next big layer of ice. 500 to 600 gallons is a ton of water, so they have to wait at least an hour before applying the next layer of ice. Altogether, the ice is going to require about 15 to 20 hours from start to finish to make. That's a super long time to build a surface that's playable. There was one time a couple years ago in Los Angeles where the Clippers, the Lakers, and the Kings all had games on the same day. Now, all three of these teams play in the exact same arena, which means that when the Lakers play, you're going to have to take care of the ice to make sure that it's playable for basketball. And when you switch back to the Kings, you don't want to ruin the ice. So you can understand why it's so tricky for ice to be playable, especially in places where arenas are shared between between basketball and hockey. So it becomes much more impressive when crews are able to switch so quickly between them. And when basketball and hockey are in the same season, which they are, teams really have to make sure that that ice is maintained well. So with all of the time that it takes to put all of this ice together, you can probably understand why it would be easier for kids in colder regions to play more hockey. The ice is naturally colder and requires a lot less money to maintain. Kids in colder regions can actually play outside on frozen lakes if it comes to that. But even just maintaining indoor rinks in these areas is a little easier because of the outdoor temperature. Kids in warmer regions are at a disadvantage in this scenario just because they're going to struggle to find many places to play hockey year-round. Unfortunately, you're not going to be able to find a ton of places outdoors to play ice hockey during the summer. I mean, even here in Southern California, it's really hard to find a place that has a cold enough rink during the winter time. But what about once the ice is made? Why do hockey players complain about ice quality? What makes ice good or bad once it's poured correctly? It's important that the building that houses the ice is kept at a cold temperature too. The Carolina Hurricanes in Raleigh, North Carolina, keep their home arena at just 63 degrees Fahrenheit so that the ice doesn't start to melt and that people don't have to keep wearing their winter coats inside. When the temperature in the buildings gets higher and the humidity inside the building gets higher because of the fog over the ice, it can make it a little soft. And soft is bad because, once again, soft means slow, and slow is bad for hockey. Soft is bad for hockey only. When the outdoor conditions are hot, it can become super difficult to maintain the ice temperature. Even a 1 degree change in the outdoor temperature and in the ice is a huge problem. So when the doors to the outside world at a hockey arena are opened in places like Raleigh, Anaheim, Los Angeles, and Tampa Bay, the ice conditions can really start to become dicey. You have to open the doors to let people in during game days, so it's something that the crew that maintains the ice really has to deal with once we start getting into the spring and into the playoff months, and they have to deal with it during preseason in September and then even in the early season in October, because those places are all warm well into October and even November. The temperature of the water underneath the ice, as well as the building temperature, are constantly needing to be altered to prevent the ice from becoming soft, especially during these spring and summer months, and the fall months as well. Because, like we said earlier, 1 degree change in the ice and 1 degree change inside the building can lead to disastrous results with the ice. As I said before, soft ice is slow ice, and slow ice is bad. Well, why is that? The NHL is a game of inches. That's something that's been repeated by several announcers. It's definitely true because tipped or bouncing pucks can really change the momentum of a game with one funny bounce. A change in the ice conditions is a change in this game of inches. Speed and crisp ice are critical for high-level gameplay like in the NHL. Slow play is not fun to watch, nor is it particularly easy on the players. To illustrate this example of why slow ice is so constricting and so hard to play on, imagine trying to run through a puddle of water. It's super fun to do, but it's really slow compared to normal running speed. So when you try to skate through little puddles on the ice, it starts to get much slower, and it takes more effort to do just the same thing that you were trying to do on crisp ice. So soft ice undoubtedly is worse for the playing. Bouncing pucks, which are a little bit more common on soft ice, are harder to control with the stick, and they result in slower shots. The NHL's hardest slap shots are a lot less fun when they're only 95 miles an hour instead of the regularly approaching over 100 miles an hour when the puck settles for the defenseman. When the slap shots are slower and the pucks are harder to control, it can become easier for the goalie to see the puck and stop the puck. So if you want to see offense in hockey, you should be rooting for the ice to be clean and crisp throughout the game. Anything worse than that, and some aspect of the game is going to be less than ideal for you as a fan. Ultimately, we want to see ice applied quickly, but effectively. We want to see it maintained to the best it can possibly be by the building crew, which can sometimes become very expensive with how cold the ice needs to be. We want to keep as much of the heat out of the building as possible, because when too much heat gets in, the ice starts to become soft and it becomes hard to skate on. And all of these principles are important because we want the best hockey possible. We want to see the best plays made, and we want to see the fastest slap shots and all that stuff. And none of that is possible unless we have good quality hockey ice. If you enjoyed this video, please feel free to drop a like or a comment or even both below. If you have any suggestions for future topics to be covered, feel free to let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time on Highly Technical Sports. If you want to learn how a Zamboni works to maintain the ice quality, please check out the link in the description below. If you want to learn how fast slap shots can go and why the ice quality matters to the slap shot, please check out the other link in the description below.